hello. I'm right here in the parking lot of the Prairie Berry Winery. Don't have too much to say about that, except they do make a good lunch. I didn't have lunch because I had that gross sandwich at the gas station, and it was really busy in there, so I, with the time constraints I was under, I wasn't going to stay and have lunch anyway. But I bought a couple bottles of wine. They make their wine out of local fruit, which is really cool. I can't remember anymore what I bought. It's gone now. Oops. But anyway, I did buy a couple bottles of wine there, and I always do when I go in the area. So now I'm headed on into Hill City. There's actually several wineries in Hill City, and I'll tell you a little something about Hill City. In fact, I've got a whole page of notes. We'll see how many I get to, because I, after my last video, I did actually plan this out a bit. But Hill City is actually the oldest existing city in Pennington County, which is where we're at. Now, fun fact, you may find this a little hard to believe when you actually see the city. Population of 948 people. It definitely does not have the main street of a town of 948 people, because I'll tell you what's going on here. This is a major tourist destination. And I'm guessing to get workers for all these businesses, they must come from Rapid City, which is actually only 26 miles away. I didn't write down what highway, but yeah. Now, there are some legitimate local businesses besides the tourism. And we can't, forget the tourism. But there's still a lumber industry. There's not much mining left, but the town actually kind of got its... almost died, but then it got reborn again because of tin mining, and then it gradually changed to tourism and timber. And actually, I've been looking at the populations of some of these towns down here. This is one that's been steadily growing. Interesting. Of course, I blame the tourism. I mean, Mount Rushmore is right there, and that opened up, I guess, in the 40s. Sturgis isn't too far away. I didn't really look up when that started, but I will when I get to Sturgis on this trip, which is a long ways from now. Interesting. 19th century, this was the home to the Lakota Sioux, but before that, the Arikara settled it in the 1500 AD. At various points, there was the Cheyenne, and yeah, I know you're saying, where's the city? We'll get there. The Cheyenne, the Crow, the Kiowa, the Pawnee, a lot of different tribes settled in this area at various times. So, I wonder if that's that pine beetle that's damaged those trees there. Sorry, side note, that's the science teacher in me coming out. I found this kind of funny. Back in the tin days, one record refers to this town as a town with a church on each end and a mile of hell between. Admittedly, there were 15 saloons at the time. And if you know much about mining towns of that era, yeah, maybe. And we're still not to the town. A lot of businesses, though, here. I found one other thing of interest. Now, there is a school there. It's a K-12 school. 506 students, K through 12. And I bring that up because the interesting thing I found was about the school. And here it is. This is the only school in the United States allowed to use Smokey Bear as their mascot. Now, why is that? Well, July 10th, 1939, there was a fire 10 miles out of town. The boys' basketball team and a number of the staff from the school helped fight the fire. The U.S. Forest Service named the school boys one of the best crews who fought the fire. And as a result, they became known as the Hill City Rangers, and, as I said, they are the only school district in the U.S. allowed to use Smokey Bear as their mascot. Now, one of the other... I just think that's cool. some of the other cool stuff about it, this is the... the Hill City train is based out of here. It's a steam engine. You've actually seen one of the trains used in the Hill City train if you've ever seen the movie Dances with Wolves. Now we're in Hill City proper. And they've used it for various other movies. I mean, it's cool. I took my parents on the Hill City train. It's takes you through the mountains. You get to view Harney Peak and just some history. kind of wished the narrator, because they had a narrator for the whole thing, would just shut up for a while. But they were better on the return trip, so okay. look at this. This is not a 968 or whatever I said population town. The reason is tourism. So I'm thankful I don't live in a town with heavy tourism. You know, yes, it makes my main street smaller and struggling, to be honest, but... And actually, I would kind of like some of these cool old businesses to be in this town, my town, and... Okay, yeah, I'm a little jealous, all right. We'll just admit it. But then again, you have to take the bad with the good. It's the tourism is the reason they have all this. I mean, look at this parking. You would have no trouble parking in my town. Here in Hill City, a little more difficult to park. Why? Tourism. I know he wasn't in the crosswalk, but what the hell. One of these buildings is an old hotel, which was owned by the mine. And it's, what's it called now? I forget. I didn't write this fact down. Anyway, a lot of history here. When we get up by Mount Rushmore, I'm not so interested in Mount Rushmore. I mean, yeah, I guess it's a big patriotic rah-rah thing, but whatever. It's a mountain with faces carved in it. School here on your right. No, left, sorry. Left is the school. I like that it's on Main Street. That's putting the school out saying, hey, this is important to our town. There was originally... a much older building from the early 1900s, but in 2002 it was torn down. No, 2003, sorry. The high school was built in 2002, and then it was torn down, because up until 2002 it was the high school. You know, I love old buildings, but sometimes they do reach, as cool as they are, they just reach a point where they can't be worked with anymore. So, I'm guessing, I don't know, but I'm guessing Hill City reached that point. Now, I'm paying special attention to which way I went here, because I was trying to remember there's some turns in Hill City, and I'm trying to remember if I took one of them. As I mentioned in the last video, I am going to take a wrong turn up here. Oops. So, I also mentioned in the last video I want to be a little more organized. And so since we're just driving through a wrong turn anyway, and I want to get into the Iron Mountain Highway stuff in the next video, I was thinking, okay, what the heck am I going to talk about in this video? Well, I'll tell you what I want to talk about. I almost talked about tourist towns, but I think that's a topic for when I come back. I think that's a sawmill, if I remember right, there on the left. Might be. It's hard to tell from this, and... I haven't driven this often enough. So, okay. Anyway, what I do want to talk about is TV. Yeah, the boob tube. So, I don't have cable. I don't have a satellite. But I do have the internet. Love my internet. I have In fact, I'm recording this right now because I'm uploading a YouTube video. And my internet is so slow when I upload videos, it becomes unwatchable. It's actually, what I'm uploading as I record this is the previous video that I'm referring to. So, how about that? Anyway, so I don't watch network TV, but I do have some TV shows I like. And I'm going to go reasonably contemporary. I may go back a few years to things that are no longer on the air. But, you know, I realized I've never really talked about what do I watch. So I found a few shows that I like. Now, I'm a science and math guy. I like my science and math to make sense. You know, not that there's that many shows about math out there. Maybe there is one, I just don't know about it. I'm leaving that possibility open. So when you listen to my list, some of it are shows where the science is just bone-crushingly stupid. And I'll just say, if the acting or the story is good enough, it can make up for that. So, one that I've been gotten into, and I've been reading the books. In fact, I am reading the latest book right now, is The Expanse. Now, that's one I respect for the science. They made a lot of effort to make the science right. Let's call it a near future. I don't think population trends in that book, the book delves into the population more than the show has so far. But they haven't really shown what we're starting to see with population, which is as a country becomes more developed, its reproductive rate slows down. You know, little things like saying, hey, women are people, and you know, things like that. But anyway, the reproduction rate goes down. So they didn't take that into account in designing this high population future. Alright, whatever. Moving on. So I like The Expanse. I really enjoy the storyline. I enjoy all the political intrigue. I enjoy the near future. Yeah. Speaking of wrong turns, I should have gone straight ahead here. I don't know why I turned here. Because I even thought, wait, wasn't it after the Mount Rushmore Road? But there was no sign saying Needles Highway this way, so I went this way. Ugh, stupid. But enjoy the scenery as we go through it. I mean, wow. the pine are a lot more scraggly up here, but it's really cool. Alright, so I enjoy The Expanse. It's a near future. They've discovered alien technology, and at this point in the series, you really don't know what's up unless you've read the books, in which case you know what's up. But I won't, since I'm talking TV and not books, I won't ruin it for you. But if I ever talk books in one of these videos, watch out, because spoiler alert. Anywho, acting is pretty decent. Science is good. I like that they involve some of the effects of spinning habitats and such in the way they pour water and whatnot. And they actually do make a nod to the fact that if you live in zero gravity and you develop and grow in zero gravity, your bones are weak, and you will be taller and you will be weaker physically. They take all that into account. And they have some different cultures. They have Earth, Mars, the Belters. Anyway, very, very good show. Very intricate. Very involved. And you can tell the universe building from the books upon which it's based. Another one I enjoy is The Walking Dead. Now, zombies. You may have seen me play a zombie survivor in my review of my Schrade tactical pen. Did I do that last summer? Seems like it was last summer. I cannot justify zombie science at all. Although I did run across a book once all about dissection of zombies and the anatomy of zombies, so I've been tempted to buy that book a few times. But anyway, yeah, I don't believe in the zombie thing, but this is more about what happens to human society after some kind of an apocalypse. The author chose to use zombies as the mechanism of his apocalypse, but it could have meant anything. You'll have your idealists, you'll have your survivors, you'll have your people that turn against each other, you'll have your strong men. So that's been interesting. Now, sometimes they've dragged out certain storylines too long. Some people, the teenage boys in the audience, would like to see more zombie smashing and blood and guts stuff, but whatevs. It's pretty good, and I've found it interesting. One of the characters, Carl, he's the son of the hero, started out as an obnoxious, I'm guessing, 10-year-old. But the series has been going on long enough, he's a teenager now. And the actor's actually a little older, because he's in college now. But he has developed as a character, and it's just been interesting to see his journey as he's become more mature, and he's become more of a man. But he's still at that young age where he's going to make impulsive, childish mistakes. I'll leave it at that, because I don't want to do any spoilers, but I've been enjoying that, and it actually got me to read some of the graphic novels. I'm not totally caught up, but I just met the Whisperers in the last graphic novel I read, and that actually led me to another series which I've enjoyed even more, which is called Outcast. That one believe it or not, you know, if we're going to go science, holy cow, is this off the science thing? It's about demonic possession. Now, I use the word demonic kind of in air quotes, but you can't see me because the camera on the laptop isn't working because of the whole screen thing. But anyway, I demonic possession, and we'll go with demon for now. We don't know exactly what they are yet in the show. Also a series of graphic novels. I've read some of them, but not all of them. And anyway, it takes place in small town West Virginia, so it's, you know, part of that flyover country that everybody likes to ignore. And poverty and all the different issues going on there. But what's kind of cool is you've got a main character who has the ability to bring these demons out of people. And you have a pastor who's been trying to remove demons from people and has thought he's been succeeding all these years, and spoiler alert here, turns out he's been failing. But I found the culture more interesting. Now, the demons don't seem to have much in the way of superpowers. It's just that they take over people and somehow hybrid with them. And, you know, I have to say the season ender was one of the more minimalist but chilling endings I've seen. You've got the hero and his daughter walking across this gas station parking lot, and a whole bunch of people just stop and stare at them. And you realize, holy cow, those are all demon-possessed people. So I don't know where it's headed, but very, very well done. Very understated. The hero is kind of finding his way, which I think is good. They're very slow to start this. I just really like it. So I'm looking forward to the next season. Now, on the same line, on a totally berserk level, I can't believe I'm going to admit this to you, but I'm going to. I found I really enjoy Z Nation. And Z Nation is so stupid. I mean, this is the one where they get rid of a bunch of zombies by rolling a giant piece of cheese at them. And yet, it's so engaging. I'm guessing because of the characters. You know, I enjoy Doc. He's a big-time stoner. Addie is kind of fun. She's a nice girl and just kind of girl-next-door sort of character, but she's turning out to be kind of tough. There's a teenager named 10K. He has a real name, but he's called 10K because his goal is to kill 10,000 zombies. And he's kind of interesting. And he's had an interesting plot twist in the latest season. And then there's Murphy, who apparently is the only known survivor of a zombie bite. And they're trying to get him to somewhere where they can find the cure for zombie bites. I'll leave the rest out so I don't spoil, you know, spoilers or whatever. But, you know, that's been kind of interesting. Now, as far as what else I watch, kind of limited. I like Longmire. That's a sheriff in small town Wyoming. So, I mean, look at my scenery here. Think about where I live. You can kind of see why I like that one. Boy, when I thought up this topic, I thought, oh God, I will have no trouble listing topics here. So I'm going to go back a little ways and list a few others, because now I'm realizing how few TV shows I watch. Holy cow, and I pay for this stuff. Sense8? That's a weird one. It's eight people who are somehow psychically linked, and they're all over the world. A lot of them have never met in the flesh, and they just became psychically linked. And I'm not sure what the whole conspiracy is, because the whole first season was all about them discovering they're psychically linked. But that's an interesting one. A little more sex than I like. And speaking of sex, the reason I say more sex than I like is because it's just kind of like violence. Sometimes you watch this violence, you're like, okay, yeah, you're just trying to drive up the action to keep the teenagers paying attention. I kind of think the same way with the sex in this sometimes. But if we're going to go with the sex thing and violence thing, because it's got both, Game of Thrones. Now, I started by reading the books, but, you know, he's... I'm not going to criticize, because my own book is kind of in the same boat right now. He hasn't published a book in a few years. But anyway, it's now passing the books. But what it is, it's a world called Westeros, and it's kind of a medieval Europe type of setting. And with magic and so on, but limited magic. So I like the fact it's mostly medieval stuff. Political maneuverings with a little bit of magic thrown in just to make it different. I haven't quite figured out the climate of this planet, because apparently they have really long winters that last years, so whatevs. But it's very well acted, very well, the special effects are very good, the settings are very good, the stories, the intricate overlapping stories, the politics, all very good. I mean, in fact, I even got my elderly parents to like it. And they're pretty conservative about stuff. So I was really surprised, because I'd gotten into it to the point I kind of got used to all the sex and violence and forgot. And I showed them the first episode, and if you've seen the first episode, I mean, we get to see all sorts of genitalia of various types and some violence and just like, oh, shoot. And incest. Let's not forget the incest. And I watched it with them, and their only remark at the end was, well, that was a little different. And I just think, oh, God, what have I done? My elderly 70-something parents, and I showed that to them. But turns out they liked it, and they bought the DVDs, because, of course, they don't have high-speed internet, because they're still on dial-up at their place. And they've read the books, and, wow, they've even recommended it to my brother, who's probably the most conservative of us all. And even he and his wife have gotten into it, so, okay. One I got into a few years ago was Firefly. You'll see shades of Firefly in my own writing, actually. Battlestar Galactica, that's over now. Not the 1970s one, because that one's awful. The new one. The 1970s one is designed to ride the coattails of the Star Wars thing and appeal to the teenagers. And the little kids, because they've got an obnoxious little kid in it with a Daggett, whatever that's supposed to be. And also, by the way, some very blatant Mormon theology, which I don't think a lot of viewers even caught, but it's, oh boy, is it obvious. By the way, the rocks you're seeing here are kind of what Mount Rushmore is carved out of, the same kind of rocks. It's not these specific ones, obviously, because we're a little close to it. And if you've ever watched North by Northwest, there is no weird Frank Lloyd Wright-esque house that spies lived in behind Mount Rushmore where you can run out and end up on George Washington's head. If you don't know what I'm talking about, watch Alfred Hitchcock's North by Northwest, 1950s thriller, starring, I don't remember his name, but he used to be a big name actor. All the women liked him, and yeah, it's not coming to me right now. Can picture him. He was in Charade. I'm sure he was in some other movies. Nostalgia. Not Nostalgia. Starts with an N, though, and it takes place in South America. Cary Grant. There we go. And Eva St. Marie is in it. And is it George Mason? And, boy, I can't remember the guy. He's tall and skinny. Yeah, I don't know. But anyway, part of it takes place at Mount Rushmore. They have a shooting at the visitor center at Mount Rushmore. He ends up at the hospital in Rapid City, which is near Mount Rushmore. And the finale, the climax, if you will, it takes place as a fight on top of George Washington's head and falling off of George Washington and all that business. I will just tell you, Mount Rushmore, my reaction to it when I saw it for the first time was, huh, that's smaller than I thought it would be. the pictures, it just seems so big, and it's not. You know, I didn't, by the way, right here, if I would turn left, Mount Rushmore parking lot. Actually, Gigantor-sized parking garage. I took my parents to Mount Rushmore. I didn't prompt them in any way. It was actually the same trip where we took the Hill City train. And I just waited to get their reaction. They both said the same thing. They're like, huh, we thought it would be bigger. So, yeah, it's smaller than you would think from the movies and media and such. So, I don't know. I'm trying to think of other TV. I said I thought it'd be easier than this. Wow. Next time I'm going to write them all down and realize what a short list it is. And I like a few old TV shows, but that's not what I was planning to list. I was going to list modern stuff and... Now that's making me think, why do I have all this Netflix and Hulu and whatnot if I'm not watching that much stuff? Ah! Angry at myself now. Let's see. There was one other... Can't think of it right now. Wow. Okay. So, yeah, I do watch some TV. I like to read. I watch some news stuff. My news I mostly do on... If I watch the news and I'm not reading, because reading is a different animal and this is a TV type thing... I do like David Pakman. I sort of like Secular Talk with, what is his name? Kyle Kalinske. David Pakman's better. Sometimes Kyle Kalinske does more of the making fun of rather than analyzing. I'll watch The Young Turks. Sometimes I think they go a little too far left without analyzing, but, see, of course, my pen reviewers that I like. I like Matt Armstrong, Stephen Brown, but, you know, everybody watches them. I watch Larry Barones, Chris Rapp 52, Grand Meow Pens, Pens and Tea. You know, there's a whole bunch of them. I'm going to forget somebody, and they'll be deeply offended. So, if I forgot you, sorry. I'm realizing I maybe don't watch as much as I thought I did. Someday I need to write down how much I watch. Like right now, I'm clearly not watching anything. I had this plan of, I read a book when I was a kid called, something about Shannara. It was a whole series of books. Anyway, Shannara something. And I just learned that there was something called the Shannara Chronicles, and I thought, oh, I could watch that. And so I've got like the first episode. I was going to try it and see if I liked it. I like some older stuff. Sandbaggers is really good TV. It's an old spy story and realistic spy. In fact, as the hero, in air quotes again, points out in the very first episode, we are not James Bond. A lot of the action takes place in offices rather than out in the field with explosions and such. All right, so here I stopped because I was trying to make up my mind, what the hell do I do now? Because I'd figured out that, yeah, I wasn't supposed to see Mount Rushmore. And I didn't know exactly how to get to this Iron Mountain Highway and Needles. I'm just like, I don't have lots of time and, you know, I don't know if I'll be able to get down here another weekend to do this. Because once the snow flies, they close it. And, of course, up in the mountains, it flies a lot earlier than it does elsewhere. And it was such a flippin' perfect day. But I looked at the map and I said, okay, I'm pretty sure I'm on the Iron Mountain Highway, just doing it the opposite direction. I'm going to go for it, and we'll see what happens. And as it turned out, other than being in not the direction I'd planned originally, this is the right direction. You are on the Iron Mountain Highway. I will talk about the Iron Mountain Highway and the pigtails and all the rest of that in the next video. But I've got about 30 seconds left before this clip ends. So I just want to thank you for watching. And stand by for the best scenery you have seen yet on my channel. The next couple of uploads are going to be absolutely spectacular. So I thank you for watching. And I'll see you later. Bye-bye.